Okay. Good evening, everyone. It's Thursday, July 2nd, 2015. Calling to order the Selectmen's meeting for the town of Hingham. First item on the agenda is approval of the minutes. And I will entertain a motion to...
Do we know what version we're voting on?
I'm getting to that. There are two separate edits, one from Paul Gannon, the other from Mary Power. I would entertain a motion that we vote to approve the minutes reflecting the edits of Ms. Power.
So moved.
Second.
I'd like to be heard just briefly.
Sure.
So the minutes that I received were not what I considered accurate in terms of two areas. Why I didn't vote for the transfer that gave Ted Lexiadis a raise, because there were no evaluations done, and there were evaluations done. They just were basically not considered, and we moved on and gave him a bonus. I didn't agree with that then. So just to be consistent, I had put it in my minutes that you know, that was the explanation. But probably more importantly, there was a lot of discussion on June 18th about me being left in the dark on appointments and discussions, and even the fact that we were going to have a process a certain way about how we were going to do the voting. And I brought it to Mr. Lexiadis' attention that basically he left me out of the loop. He confirmed later that he had spoken to you on individuals like Jim Claypool, but he never talked to me about it. So I thought that should be reflected, since I spent probably 10 minutes talking about it, and the only thing that was listed in the minutes was that I had some kind of disagreement with my colleagues as my board of selection. But I think I made it very clear that my problem on that evening was not with my colleagues, because I knew that they weren't aware of it, that they weren't aware that I wasn't kept in the loop. So what I did was I put minutes together that reflected a summary of that. And I don't know if Mary wants to comment on it, since they're her minutes, but I don't know why we wouldn't include a brief description of what actually happened in the interest of transparency. It is only a summary, but to characterize what happened on the 18th is only a disagreement between my colleagues and I would just not be accurate. So again, I don't know if Mary has any thoughts on it.
I think my thought was that when some of the text that is here in the minutes highlighted in red, I think Mr. Lexiadis took exception to some of that, and not being privy to a conversation between the two of you, it kind of to me felt like a, you know, he said. When I first read this, I think, Paul, you've captured some of your comments, but I think Paul and I also, equally, we had a lot of discussion. I think we probably had a discussion of 30 to 40 minutes on the process. I think I shared some perspective, Paul did, and, we can either have these minutes try to be a transcript of all of these conversations, or, you know, a summary from the clerk. My hesitation about adopting this paragraph is that it doesn't contain some of Paul Healy's comments, some of my comments. Rather than have, you know, me add a paragraph, I think the record of the clerk, and the reason that we have the clerk here is to adopt the minutes. If, you know, in fairness, we want to adopt the minutes that the clerk had without the one edit I made, I'm, you know, happy to do that.
I was fine with your edit, by the way.
Okay.
I communicated that to Ted. But as you said, Mary, the stuff that I put in there really is about the conversation that I had with Ted. And so Okay. So you could put your perspective in about anything you want. And if you actually talked about it on the 18th, I would have been okay with
sure.
It. So my point is I want to keep it short too. I think I only put a few sentences in there. But in the interest of transparency, I mean, this was an issue for me of great magnitude.
I understand.
And it has taken a whole new level, it has taken to a whole new problem for this town based on what happened on the 18th and what happened with the process. And I, you know, I'm going to be talking about the process tonight, I intend to, but the bottom line is that it's important for this town to understand that I was left out of the loop. It was important for this town that I didn't know about what was going on for the votes, because I only saw 7 votes when I met with the town administrator, and I didn't see the other document till Thursday morning. And it's important that I didn't know that Jim Claypool was not going to be considered for reappointment, even though he'd already been contacted by Betty Tower. But you folks knew about that stuff, but people need to know that, because I can't work effectively with my colleagues if the town administrator is not going to inform me.
All right.
That's it.
We're going into an area that I think is problematic, and I think we should just take the vote. We can take our respective positions and go forward accordingly. So I'll second the motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed?
No.
All right. Let's move on to the next item.
Rachel, I would just give you this and make it part of the record. It's 9 minutes that I...
Okay. Question.
Thank you.
I'm getting to that, Bob. It's questions from the public regarding items not on the agenda. Could you just identify yourself by name and address?
Maybe I have some good news for you today, which you might be able to use. They tried to put the flag up down the square. Okay. It's been up for, I think, 50 years. Maybe you know better than I. They tried to get up and the wire broke, right? But they couldn't get it up. That would have been the end of the flag for the 4th of July. 3 town employees volunteered their time on their day off to get the wire up. They contacted the bank, which allowed them to go up on the roof, tie the wire on the cupola, run across the street, get on the pole, get the flag up. They were there from 9 o'clock in the morning until 4 o'clock in the afternoon. They got the flag up. They got it down the hull. They had it stitched so they could put weights on it so it wouldn't wrap around the flag. I just think that 3 employees that gave their time up should get some recognition for doing that. You know, so this is the only reason I'm bringing it up. They did a good job. You wouldn't have had a flag if it wasn't for them. So I just wanted to mention them.
Do you know who those 3 employees are?
One of them is Captain Bill Powers. The other one was Captain Rob Keyes. That has a name similar to mine. And a fellow named John Menton from the light company. So the 3 of them are down there all day, and they did a great job in doing it. So I just meant, you know, to see the flag up. And it wouldn't have been up because the wire had broken. The wire was 40 years old. And
sure.
That was the end of it, you know. And the flag was 30 years old, and it's been replaced by a brand new flag now. So it looks good.
You know. Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you for pointing that out. Thank you for bringing that to our attention. Anybody else?
Nice to see a microphone at my height. My name is Dave Sargent. I'm at 304 Tucker's Lane, Hingham, of course. I'm here to ask questions as to the steps and process of the previous discussion on the non-renewal of Jim Claypool's term on the Veterans Council, which to the veterans has become an unconscionable act, one which appears to have no foresight, foreplanning, or thought before it happened. You might also explain when it was done and when Jim was notified. So if we could hear those steps, that would be great. To qualify my presence here, I am a combat decorated Vietnam veteran, 100% disabled. I'm a member of the Veterans Council, the American Legion, and commander of the VFW. So your remarks would be greatly appreciated, and thank you for the time.
Thank you, Mr. Sargent. I will respond. And rather than speak to the individual, I think I'd speak to the process, because I decline to speak to the individual, as I believe that that would be inappropriate in these circumstances. It's the custom of the Board of Selectmen to appoint members to most town committees for 2 terms at most, and then to make the slot available for contributions from new volunteers. We have done so in this instance. The moderator generally uses this practice as well. This has served our town well in the past. What can happen in other towns where they don't have such a practice is that sometimes long-time committee members, as a result of all the hard work they've done, come to have a sense of ownership of their committee and of the area of operations of that committee. Our experience is that it's best to have a system which ensures that new ideas and new leadership have an opportunity to develop. This has really served our town well. It's hard to tell talented volunteers that we'd like to roll their position over. These folks have worked hard and cared deeply about the work they've been doing. But on balance, we find it's best to use all the talent we have available on a rolling basis and not let the membership of a committee become static, as it would if everyone stayed and no one new could participate. After all, these committees represent the whole town, not just the views of the longest-serving members. There are individual boards and committees, however, which are exceptions, and where the best practice is to allow members to serve longer. These are boards which either require special knowledge and expertise not generally available to the public, or where it's in the best interest of the town to keep that specialized knowledge on that committee. Examples include the Conservation Commission, where it takes almost 3 years just to learn the law which they must enforce, the Zoning Board of Appeals, the Lincoln School Apartment Managers, the Personnel Board, and there are others. These are all cases where the technical expertise needed to do the best job is not in large supply, and keeping that experience on the committee is in the best interest of the town because it would be very difficult or impossible to replace. But most committees, for example, the Bear Cove Park Committee, the Harbor Development Committee, the Traffic Committee, and many others, can be populated by many members of our community, and many volunteers are interested in serving. For these committees, it makes sense to take advantage of all the talent that we have available. That's why we generally seek to refresh committee membership on an ongoing basis, and we do that by filling posts with new volunteers on a regular basis.
I'd like to be heard. That would all be well and good if circumstances didn't point us in a different direction, okay? I think people in the audience and people at home need to know that on April 8th of this year, Betty Tower, who has stepped down at some point in time, she was the person that was in charge of reaching out to chairs and so forth to find out and make the determinations for us, because Mr. Alexiadis, admittedly so, was not involved in that part of the process. She specifically sent Jim Claypool a email asking if he wanted to be reappointed. And there were two other members as well. And she pointed out, since they had been doing the appointment process, he had served a 2-year term and then a 3-year term. He may well have been involved. And I could tell you he's been very involved with the veterans and the council from the very beginning, including the Foss Monument. So here's one dilemma. The town has already reached out to Jim Claypool and asked him if he wanted to be back on. And I pulled out the email. I have been a member of the Veterans Council since we formed it. I have one more duty I must perform before I step down, to finalize the Herbert Foss Memorial at the shipyard. I owe that to his memory and the promise I made to his family 5 years ago. The Veterans Council is taking the lead to bring the Foss Memorial to reality, and nothing or no one should block it. Please schedule the reappointment of my other two colleagues, which I don't need to mention. So the town reached out to a distinguished veteran in this town, a person who's poured his heart and soul, not only for his country, but for this town. And he accepted the reappointment. Now, I've heard that people didn't know about that, and the selectmen's are, but that's no excuse, because he was asked, and he accepted. And I personally believe that to try to hang our hat, and I certainly am outraged, and I certainly think it's unconscionable. I didn't even know it happened because I was kept in the dark. I'm very upset about that, by the way. But to hang our hat on the fact that he didn't serve two terms, for all he's done, for the fact that he responded, and for the fact that he had one more mission to accomplish. He's a veteran. He deserves the utmost respect. And if he's going to be disrespected and kicked to the curb, who's next? I won't stand for it. I'm only one vote. I don't accept the explanation if that's what it hinges on. And I am sad day for this town. I will say this. There's a simple solution to all this. I asked Ted Alexiadis to reach out to my colleagues and say, can we get him back on the committee? I was told that Mary had an interest in putting him on for a year so we could finish his mission. That sounded great to me. No one told me till after the deed was done. But I asked Ted to go to them and say, can we find a way? Because we want to avoid this. We want to be respectful to this man. He's done so much for this town. I was told by Ted that they were comfortable with their vote. But we know that by statute, we can have 15 members on this council. It's a volunteer committee. It seems kind of as a punishment of some kind, some type of vindictive action against this good man when we have a simple solution. So what, you know what, if we made a mistake, if it was a mistake, we have a simple solution. We're allowed to have extra members. So why don't we just put him on there, let him finish his mission, and then he can step down in dignity. There is no justification for doing this. And in the process is in shambles, because we talk about letting people get involved, new blood. Well, there's new blood that have gone through the talent bank application. There's new blood that have been interviewed. And at the last minute, somebody makes a phone call and says, I've got someone interested, and they're going to get on a committee. They didn't even get interviewed. They didn't even submit an application. What, is that fair to the people that they went through the process? No. So we have a lot of work to do, but I don't accept that. And I'm still working on it, because I think justice and fairness to this veteran is putting him back on that committee in some form. And I again ask my colleagues, let's find a way to let him finish his mission. What harm does it do to let him be on there? It only makes us look bad. It makes look like it's being spiteful. It looks like there's some type of payback of sorts. I'm upset. This gentleman deserves better. Well, you know what? I can read, Paul, a very calm statement that I prepared or you prepared. I'm upset, and I want people to know I'm upset. This stuff should not happen. Where I grew up, this is beyond the pale to go after a veteran of that kind. He wasn't even notified, and when he was talked to, he was accepted. He was appointed. We just can't turn a blind eye to that. And I thank the veterans who came, and I thank the veterans who contacted me, and I, again, will offer my support to any sense or compromise that we can do to let him finish the job. We're talking about a Medal of Honor winner that's being honored in large part because of Jim Claypool's actions. My God, why can't we do something? What's wrong? What does it say about us if we can't find a way to do it? Are we going to hold fast and just commit ourselves to saying, too bad? We have a way out, is what I'm trying to tell you guys. And the last thing I'll tell you is when I asked Mr. Alexiadis for what my colleagues' positions were on, I was told that they said not to tell me, that they were, whatever they said to Ted was between them and Ted. Can you imagine that on this issue, when I want to have some type of discussion with my colleagues, Ted, and I'm assuming he's telling me the truth, tells me they don't want me to know what their position is. So again, I'll wait to hear from you folks, but that's what Ted said to me.
Was that said?
What I told Mr. Gannon was that both of you had indicated to me that you would make your comments known here in the meeting.
Okay, well, that's not you. True.
No, of course.
Okay, okay.
Wow.
I have a few things to say, and they're not in any particular order, so I'll apologize in advance if there's any disorganization. First of all, with respect to appointments, the only people that make appointments are the Board of Selectmen. I've heard Betty Tower's name. I've heard Mr. Alexiadis. It's important to remember that our town administrator's office, they gather information, they ask if people are interested, they provide information, but at the end of the day, it's this three-person board. So if anyone has any concern or issue about the appointments, it lies with these three people who are elected by all of you, and that responsibility stops here. And I understand that there may be times when some of the decisions that we make are unpopular with some, but I think to suggest that any of our town staff or any of our employees were making commitments on behalf of the board or influencing things, I can tell you that certainly they didn't do that. That wasn't the case for me. I've heard words such as punishment, vindictive, no foresight, no planning, and I will say that the vote I made 2 weeks ago was given a lot of thought. It was in no way any sort of a punishment. It was in no way vindictive. It was based on my assessment of what was in the best interests of the Veterans Council. As I said 2 weeks ago, I think we're very fortunate in this town to have an abundance of qualified candidates. And every time that we make an appointment with somebody, there is the potential that someone else doesn't get appointed. And from my perspective, we are not punishing anyone. We are not being vindictive. We are not going after people. I don't care for, and I resent the implication that it is. In my case, I look at all the different appointments. I look at the composition of the committee. I look at the work that's taking place. I look at the diversity within the community. I look at the slate of candidates. It's true that we have a talent bank process that is an important vehicle for talent to be identified by the town. It's not the only way we identify talent. And going through a talent bank application and interview is not necessarily a prerequisite. It is a way for people to get involved. But we contact other committee members. We see if people are interested. And so, you know, the talent bank is an important piece, but it's not the only piece. I think it's really important on committees that we look at the construct of committees, and what people may not understand is that a lot of times the committee size and the committee composition is driven by either our town bylaws or by Mass General Law. So, for example, the advisory committee where I came from is a town bylaw that says it's a 15-person committee, et cetera. And most of these appointments are that way. The Veterans Council is that way. It is a certain composition and size. There are guidelines as to who are the members. I don't think it's a good practice to change the size and composition of a committee for an individual. I think those things should be premised on the work. I think it should be premised on the issues in the town. And I think that if we start to do that, you know, we're going to have every town committee in here over the next couple weeks saying, you know, we'd like to change the composition of this committee. We'd like to add more. I made a vote. I would say the last thing here is that, and I said this 2 weeks ago. You know, when we had a slate of candidates, we had a list of people, and we had a list that indicated openings on committees and individual status. I agree with some of the comments that Paul made about the benefit of having people serve for a limited amount of time. I think it has all the value that Paul's already expressed. I will say that I looked very carefully. I spent a lot of time. I really did my homework. I understood every appointment I was making. I understood what it meant for the person who was appointed. I understood what it meant in terms of potentially who was not appointed or who was not reappointed. I made those assessments. There's no new information for me that would cause me to change that. I would also say that 2 weeks ago, our town administrator staff spent the better part of the day putting together letters to notify individuals affected by our appointments, because we've had the circumstance in past years that's very uncomfortable, where somebody goes to a meeting, they haven't been reappointed, and their replacement is there. And that's really uncomfortable. Knowing that our votes were not final until our meeting 2 weeks ago, we couldn't make any sort of notification because nobody would have known what would have happened. We can't talk about appointments outside of this meeting. That would be an open meeting law violation. And the suggestion that that's the way the process has worked in the past, well, it's an open meeting law violation, and I'm not interested in doing that again. Whether it happened or not, I'm not going to do that. So we come into this meeting, and we kind of have no idea what's going to happen. But I can assure you that the Selectman's office on Friday morning sent letters of notification, making appointments, thanking people who completed their service. As I've gone through the last 2 weeks, I think that there is value in us taking a look at that notification process, particularly if people are not reappointed, because I think perhaps getting a letter in the mail might be expedient, but it may be more suitable to make a personal phone call. I think there's room to look and say, what do we maybe want to do differently? I understand that we have a lot of very qualified people in this town. I certainly, with, you know, with respect to Mr. Claypool, I think he has had a distinguished career as a volunteer in many different ways throughout the town, which are very valued. And as I said, over the last 2 weeks, there's no new information to me that would cause me to change my vote on this particular matter.
Anybody else like to comment?
I'd like, well, Bob, can I just say one thing?
About?
Just let me just say one thing about that. I think it's important for you to hear. Thank you, Bob. So, Mary, just so you know why the comment from Ted came from, I was told, it was reported to me, that you had considered putting him on, Mr. Claypool, for 1 year so he could complete his mission, so to speak, okay?
Okay.
So let me finish. So I asked Ted, I said, is that true? I said, you know, did Mary do that? And he specifically said to me, Mary had told me, and she said Paul as well, but Mary had told me not to communicate with you what your thoughts were, okay? So that's the part he left out. The second part was that he would talk about it at the meeting. I have no problem with you doing that, Mary. I don't think that's, I think that's a sign of dysfunction if you're not going to communicate through the proper channels in the proper way, but you have the right to do that. But in essence, that's what he said to me.
Okay.
So just so you know, he did say it. You asked him, he denied it, but he did say it.
Okay.
And that's why, and that's why.
And I would also just, I would just comment on that. First of all, the mission is the council's mission. The mission of the long overdue recognition of Mr. Foss is the mission of the council. And in the appointment process, as I was looking at the appointments, I did ask the town administrator if it would, you know, whether there might be a possibility to do something. And what I understand is that the status of the recognition at the Intermodal Center is nearing its completion, and I took that into account in making the appointments that I did.
That doesn't make it a bad thing that you consider that, Mary. I thank you for doing that. But for me not to be able to get information like that because Ted tells me you told me not to
tell
me.
Well, and let's
just saying, this doesn't make any sense. I mean, I would have echoed that, and that we could have had a conversation, not together, but we through Ted about finding a way to resolve this, because he does deserve to be there. The council wants him there. He's a veteran. We owe them the utmost respect. And the fact that Betty Tower did communicate, she was the person in charge before you got on the board, by the way. She was, and I was told that she was the person that kind of ran the reappointment. So to say that she wasn't involved in the process is not accurate. I'm just telling you.
What I would say is that it would seem to me that feel like we're kind of throwing Betty under the bus a little here.
No, we're not. She did her job. Betty, somebody dropped the ball, or somebody took it.
I think
ran the other way.
Betty's job is not to appoint, reappoint, or make any commitments with respect to appointment. That lies with the three of us. And if there was a perception that a conversation with a member of the town staff implied appointment, again, that's something that we need to take a look at. And make sure that people don't get that idea. Because at the end of the day, the appointment process is made, the appointments are made by these three people.
Last thing I'll say is, you know, you said you did your work, right? And I believe you did. You're a hard worker, Mary. But this person that replaced our leader, our veteran, I did not know who he was. I never heard his name until Thursday morning when he showed up on a list that Ted prepared. How am I supposed to be able to look into somebody's credentials and look into whether I want to vote for him or not when I don't even know who he's replacing? And then his name just magically appears on a list with no information. He didn't submit a talent bank application. He didn't go through an interview. That's not right.
Well, I would say that I had the same experience on Thursday morning. So what I actually did was I picked up the phone, and because when we got the appointment list, some of the appointments were names that I had put forward. Other appointments for other positions were names that both of you had put forward. Some of those names I was less familiar with, just, you know, I was less familiar. So when I received that list on Thursday, knowing that I was going to be expected to vote on those that night, I took the time to contact the town administrator's office to get the background so that I felt like I could make an informed vote. And when I did that for all of the positions where names were other than what I had submitted, I received the assurance that of the individual's qualifications, and so that informed my votes on Thursday evening.
Well, the only thing I'll tell you is that something's amiss here, because when I called Ted, I picked up the phone on Thursday morning and said, what's going on? Besides telling me that he already had the two votes, which would be one of yours, so I don't know how, I'm just saying the perception was, Ted told me, was he already had talked to you guys, and you were already voting for all these people on the list, and all the letters had already been put together. And that's a fact.
Did that happen?
That's a fact.
No, it did not.
Okay.
Of course it did.
We went through this last meeting.
I called them up.
Can we not do this again, please?
Well, I just want Mary in the audience to know that I picked up the phone as well.
All right, well, we'll...
And I made an inquiry, and I was basically told, you know, it's already done. They already have the two votes. So
does anybody else want to speak to this issue? Mr. Beal? Just identify yourself by name and address, please.
Robert Beal, 71 Elm Street. I, too, am a combat Vietnam veteran. I am not 100% disabled. And until recently, I served proudly on the Veterans Council. I left that Veterans Council because of actions of this board and actions of the town historian pertaining to the dedication and understanding and recognition to Seaman Foss and his activities associated in the Spanish-American War. And this board, in general, the Board of Selectmen, allowed the town historian to say and demean the Veterans Council, to say the Veterans Council was responsible for the debacle associated with all of the misinformation that went on to bring recognition to Seaman Foss. And I took it so personally, I was not sleeping at night because I thought somehow I had made a serious, serious error. And if there's one thing I am, is honest. And I searched evenings. I could not sleep trying to find acknowledgement and recognition for another individual named and pertaining to the Medal of Honor in the town of Hingham. Because the last thing I wanted to do was to turn around and misperch anyone that may have received and belonged in this town to have been recognized for the Medal of Honor. Since 1995, the town website here has listed Seaman Foss is the only Medal of Honor recipient in the town of Hingham. No one challenged that until it became the traction to get Seaman Foss recognized for his endeavors. And the things I heard outside of here is what I've heard outside of here. Now, I left, I asked the board, I told the board, I will not seek, will I not accept reappointment to the council. I received calls. I received calls from members of the Board of Selectmen. I received a call from Ted Alexiadis begging me to try to come back. We need you because you're very important. And Paul, you made statements about a single individual. I'll tell you, Jim Claypool and I politically think on the opposite sides of the spectrum beyond your wildest imaginations. Those are our political views. Jim and I believe and support veterans. And up until the time that the decision I made because of my health and welfare and I could no longer represent this town and this council by what had gone on, I was co-chair to that council. So it was not one individual. Not one individual did not have control or manipulation or anything to do with the Veterans Council. And it may be we have 15 members, and I know we're always hard-pressed to fill the board with a full 15-member complement. And I think if we looked, we'd probably find that we don't have 15 members. Now, coincidentally, the person that replaced Jim stepped up during that FOSS process and came up with five other individuals with linkage to Hingham associated with the Medal of Honor. Linkage. What does that mean? Nothing. Nothing. But it was, again, to turn around and cloud and draw attention away from an individual because he was a seaman. He wasn't a general, he wasn't a captain, he was a seaman. A seaman that did something that was extraordinary, and really, when you look into the history, it brought a much quicker end to the entire Spanish-American War. A single act of a hacksaw on a telecommunication cable in a rocking rowboat with 1,500 Spaniards firing down on them. He deserves to be recognized. And Jim's whole accomplishment is simply to get some recognition. Now, Paula, you and I had a conversation. You first became a selectman. I was with my son in North Carolina. You was with someplace with your son about when it was the middle school. And we had a discussion, and you just really just did not, you lobbied not to do that. And my if you remember, I told you, I said, I was just tired of the divisiveness, that something had to be done and put to a solution. It didn't matter to me. It was a school. That wasn't that big a deal, but it had to be done. And Senator Hedlund stepped forward to cut that. And we have the intermodal. All Jim wants to do, and all Jim's ever wanted to do, was to get that recognition. And I don't think we have 15 members. And I know sitting on that board for the time I sat on the board, we were hard-pressed to get oftentimes, because whatever situation, a full quorum. And that council supports our veteran service officer. That's our whole purpose. Years back when I originally was on the Memorial Day, Veterans Day Committee, which is what we were, we did those two events. Then it became something that the VSO, because of the caliber of professionalism brought to by Keith German, needed a council to help support him. And though I understand what you're saying about Mary Foley being a hired hand in the town and simply a clerical person in the office, every time Keith German, because he was the VSO, came to those meetings when people were up for re-election or renomination, whatever term you want to use, that letter came through the Board of Selectmen via Betty Foley. Mm-hmm. She was the vehicle of this board to represent and pass that on. Are you interested? And then she took that information and brought it back to this board. That's in facts. And I read the story about the June 18th representation, and I looked at that and I said, something's not right. Paul, I don't know. I wasn't there. I don't know. Something wasn't right. And you were in the dark, whatever. I don't know that to be true. I've heard yings and yangs back and forth. But the one thing I heard was that it seems to be clear, I think maybe tonight followed up with, that you really weren't in the loop by whatever means. Maybe you slipped and fell and the paper, you know, dog ate your homework. I don't know. But Paul, you, after that vote was taken, the quote, if it's anywhere near accurate, and believe me, I've sat on the side of being quoted numerous times in the 40 years that I've served in this town, was, my impression was it was kind of like the end of a cartoon, that's democracy in action. It seemed to be very lightly lied, you know, like that vote was how democracy works, that he was left in the dark, presumably. We'll give him a shadow of a doubt. But that vote was done. And the individual that replaced Jim, we embraced because of that. We asked him to come on to the FOSS committee, people that were on the FOSS committee, because I was also part of that FOSS committee, because he seemed to have, you know, he'd done 25 years of research on the depot. That's on, what street is that on? That's on Beale Street. I apologize to the town members, it's the street the town named after my family, which seems to be a big problem today to name anything after anyone. But then again, so be it. And I grew up there until I was 4 years old in the barracks. My playground, up until I left the barracks and my dad was in the Marine Reserves after World War II, we played there with now Pal Fields. That was our playground. That's what we did. I got caught more than once and brought home playing in Route 3A traffic. I've lived here, I've done these things. But you can't just turn around and do this kind of stuff. It's just not right. And if we don't have 15 members on the board, and you can't turn around, a person applied, he stepped up, and he accepted a position, he dissolved the position within 1 month, he never came to a meeting 2 years ago, and then he becomes a member. Fine, that's fine. But you remove someone who has worked hard, and I'll be the first to admit, not the easiest man to work with. But I'll tell you, his heart and soul is exactly where it is. We wouldn't have that memorial out there, and people don't begin to know that when he's reached into his pocket and done things to help widows, veterans, and people in this town, because he doesn't pat himself on the back, he does it. He does it from wherever he is, he does it. Because he's in charge. He's our, you know, and I did it, and we all do it. And the men sitting here that are on that council do that. it's not right. And if we don't have 15 members, which I don't believe we do, I don't understand. And if I understand correctly, maybe I'm misconceived in my information, a person was appointed and he was given chairmanship of the Veterans Council. Is that true?
The Veterans Council,
no.
At the Veterans Council next meeting, the council will elect its...
Okay, well, see, that's, see, part of the rumor that goes out there, and it's not from these individuals, is that he was appointed and he's chairman.
That's a decision for the council to make.
Exactly.
Whoever is its chair.
Now, Paul also mentioned about the 3 years. I served a bunch of years on the board, on the Conservation Commission. And, you know, fortunately or unfortunately, the entire time I was on that commission, I was chairman. Not because I petitioned for that, but because the board members we had felt as though I did that job. And I was taken off their board after 3 terms. It was a political decision, because that's the politics of the Board of Selectmen. You know, you want to bring in your blood, you want to bring in your whatever it is. I think you're still doing the best, but then again, this thing's Veterans Council, we have veterans, we have non-veterans, but every single person on that council has one thing, is to support the men, women, and families of those people that raised their right hand, took an oath to this country, up to and including their life. Just to give you a little background on me, I went to go in the Army. I wanted to be a, because when I was in junior in high school, we lost Curtis. And Curtis was killed in Vietnam. I said, what do we do? He's the first person killed in Hingham. So I went to join the Army. Passed all, the recruiter loved me. I passed every exam there was, went to the physical, flunked it. Physical requirement that would not allow me not only to enlist, but I couldn't be drafted. Vietnam, that's a golden handshake. That didn't sit with me. I found a way to go in the Air Force, get my physical defect corrected to serve in the United States Air Force. Once getting there, Vietnam started to get to be so fractured about good, bad, and different that I said, I volunteered to go to Vietnam. I didn't do this so I could come back and pat myself on the back and stand up here and say, what a hero I am. I am not a hero. I'm a patriot. I'm a patriot who turns around and believes this. This is what we do. Now, not recently, long ago, after this whole thing to do it, during the process of FOSS, and there was questions about some other representation, a statue, the lone sailor, and Paul, you and I had a long meeting, and we left that meeting after 2 hours up in his home office, and we walked out of there to agree to disagree because it wasn't representative. Paul, you were very upset by that. You thought you could kind of lobby me into it. It wasn't the thing, because that statue was beautiful. I came to the following meeting. I suggested in public session that statue, if it were to come to Hingham, which I think is a great facility, belongs down at the LST Memorial in the harbor. I received calls after the meeting that someone, after they left here, was very upset with my public comments. You know, the one thing that I fought for, and every man here has fought for, freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, freedom to worship, and freedom not to have fear. So we went on to that, and we went there. Now, about the time that this whole debacle created over the FOSS and who you know who was here, what was there, I came up for reappointment to the GAR. That's what I do now. I'm a trustee of the GAR. And I come there, and we do the things we do there, and probably most people in the town have never been there. And we have folks there that we do our utmost to bring people in there so they can see what this building was. At one time, the GAI, just a long-term lease to it, we almost lost the building for a dance studio because it was such a dollar a month forever, and it took time to get back. We get that back. That's a huge, historic building to this town. I was told that I was sent an email by a Board of Select member that my appointment had been held by you, Paul, because you felt as though there was some bad blood over the whole process and you wanted to call me to clear the air. Not only did you not call me, I get reappointed to the GAR. I don't know. So I don't know where it is. All I know is right now the process is broken. And if people have specializations, which you list in your comments, Paul, the specialization and what this town owes, if nothing else, to Jim Claypool, is to let him finish this job. The one thing we've learned in the military is you leave no one behind. You've just caused Jim to leave behind Seaman Herbert L. Foss, recipient in the Medal of Honor, because it was his life. He was leaving. Believe me, he was leaving when that was done. He had done enough. What are you, a couple years older than me?
He was done. We don't have a full board. Our mission is to serve the VSO, the widows and wives and families of those people that serve this country. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else like to speak? Okay. And in that case, we're going to move on to the next item. Application from May Brothers for a limousine license.
Do you want to come forward? You all have a packet in your file regarding the request of May Brothers for a limousine license. Betty Foley went through the process that we apply now. Quite a few years ago, we had an issue with a number of illegal, or unlicensed, I should say, rather than illegal. You could draw your interpretation. Unlicensed limousine companies, this is not one of them, and this process has produced people coming forward so that we have the appropriate checks for the public that are using the vehicles.
Mr. Gannon, any questions?
How you doing?
I'm all right.
Should be a little bit easier.
Sure?
I think so.
Okay.
So I didn't... how long have you been in business, or have you worked elsewhere?
2012. Okay. I was in Seekonk before.
Seekonk?
Seekonk, yeah.
Okay. How many vehicles do you have?
Right now, I have one.
Okay.
Just when I get a license, it can go more than that for them.
Okay. Thank you.
Ms. Powell?
No, I would just say for the benefit of the audience that there is a policy and procedure for limousine licenses that provides a lot of detail around ensuring proper certification, to making sure that that the vehicle is licensed, registered, subject to inspection. Lieutenant Narkaitis has reviewed the application, has reviewed the vehicle, and the Hingham Police Department is recommending that we approve this license, which I'm inclined to offer a motion if you
would.
Sure. I'd like to move to approve the issuance of a limousine license to May Brothers Inc., care of Admel Elanawi. Beg your pardon if I mispronounced that. 99 Derby Street. May Brothers Inc. has been approved for one vehicle, and Ahmed Elanawi is the sole limousine driver.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you for coming in this evening.
Next item on the agenda. Nice and smooth.
All right, we have a Hingham Farmers Market update. Bob, the best. Well, I guess we're taping that. I don't know if that's going to show.
I don't know. I brought it.
It's a little too small, but I'll pass it to the board so they can look at it.
I think
we have it in our packets.
You do?
Yes.
We do. Evening, everybody. I'm Mark Cullings, 44 Spring Street, president of the Hingham Farmers Market. This is Beverly Vernon.
Mm-hmm. 31 School Street.
Hi, yep. How are you?
Hello.
Beverly is the vice president of the Farmers Market and co-chairman of the Friends of the Hingham Farmers Market. Thank you for the time. We won't take up a lot of it. Basically, I asked for the time to come to you to thank a bunch of the town departments. Your office, the Department of Health, the Department of Public Works, the police department, everyone who has been involved in helping this market get up and running and become the success that it is. What we are witnessing this year, and in your packets earlier when I sent it around, is a chart that shows that we are tracking this year. So this is the third year that we've done actual attendance tracking, and we are tracking well ahead of the two previous years when we began this. We're very proud of that.
Mm-hmm.
The vendors are very happy. Our patrons seem to be very happy because they keep coming. The parking lot gets a little congested, but again, thanks to uniform
detail
officers to help us depressurize situations that arise briefly and can happen most any time. We think that's been handled very well. Last week was very interesting. I think Paul, you experienced it. We had people who had, this happens every year during fireworks seasons, when there are pre-parkers, people who leave their vehicles overnight, and this is something that's been going on for years, and we wouldn't change it. But it does constrict the parking lot. So our detail officer was terrific. And some of us in the market, Beverly, I, mm-hmm. Bill Marshall, were helping the officer, directing people to vacant spaces, and everything seemed to go very well. And I would like to pay special attention or recognition to Lieutenant Narkaitis, who has helped us the last two or three years with the on the 4th of July and the fireworks night, just help us keep the footprint of the farmers market open for that time. So thank you for all of the help. We have a suggestion regarding the goose population. The town has embarked on a remediation project that we find as probably the heaviest user of the parking lot to have been a great success. It began last year. It was kind of hit and miss, but the geese have been discouraged from coming to the grassy areas. Consequently, the asphalt of the farmers market where we set up is much cleaner than it has ever been. But not only that, the mosquito count in our anecdotal experience is way down, and the grass is clean. We have a lot of people, a lot of families who come to the market. You know, we set up on a distinct footprint area of the parking lot. There's lovely grass, trees, and a beach right adjacent to it. It's been up to this year, that area has been foul, literally. Excuse the pun, we used that pun in previous years. But the goose dropping situation was just terrible. It doesn't exist this year. And what we would like to offer as a contribution, we'd like to give the town some picnic tables for that area, three or four, not a lot, but just to that they would be there seasonally, and it would give our patrons an opportunity to shop at the farmers market and be able to sit down and relax a little bit. So that's a suggestion. I'm not asking you for a decision tonight, but I'd like to make it a formal proposal for you to consider. And then finally, there is the matter of the proclamation of Hingham Farmers Market Day, which is August 8th this year. And we would like Hingham to have a special day.
We have a program where we do have a official bell ringer, so we invite a representative to come and open up the market that day on and celebrate all farmers markets throughout the state of Massachusetts.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Grant,
Mr. Gannon.
Thank you. On the picnic tables, I know it's not really in front of us, but it's all part of the discussion, so to speak. Is that something that you folks would provide?
I'd like to condition it. We're willing to work with DPW or anybody else in the town for the type of picnic table, and but we can't maintain them. So, and store. There are picnic tables on the other side of the bathing beach that the trustees have. So, we'd like to see them happen, we don't have storage and the capability of maintaining it. So it's a that's But in terms of design and materials and all of that, we would expect to and want to work with the town for to be sure that they're appropriate for that particular area. But there's nothing there now, and people put down blankets, and this year they can do it without wondering what they're going to be putting their blankets on and taking home. So.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much for your support of the farmers market.
Do you, so Ted, how would we, I mean, this question of kind of storage and maintenance, is that a question that we take to the DPW?
Yeah,
how can we advance that idea and answer that question?
Well, I think I heard Mark say that they're willing to purchase the tables.
Yes.
And I think that's something that the town could, depending on the quantity, I think you were talking about
three or four.
I'm sure we could find space for three or four picnic tables.
Is there, so Brady's going to realize that I'm not very good at science, but I guess the one question I would have is, does establishing those picnic tables, is that in any way going to encourage these geese that we've worked so long to get rid of? I know the Bathing Beach trustees had worked very carefully to understand a mitigation. I might just suggest reaching out to them to work with the company that they've worked with to just see if there are any concerns that they might have about, you know, you're going to have a greater area where there's going to be, you know, food products. We just don't want to backslide on the geese issue, and I know you don't either. So let's just reach out to the Bathing Beach trustees if we could.
We can bring this back to you for a vote.
I would also just add, being a patron of the farmers market, just for the public, one of the things that I think is important for people to understand with respect to parking, particularly as you are growing in popularity, is that the farmers market has an agreement with the Bathing Beach trustees that first row of parking right along the water be designated for people who go to the bathing beach. And I know sometimes when I go in there, it's difficult to remember. I can't remember if there's signage, but if and that's part of the reason for having the duty officer. But as people could please remember that is really allowing the farmers market to operate as guests of the bathing beach. It allows those who want access to the beach to have access. So if we can all just remember that as we're going to our various places.
Thank you.
That would be helpful.
That's exactly right. And the signage used to be better.
Yeah.
It could be better than it is now. The signs were, there were more signs there. They were damaged over this past winter.
Yeah.
And there's only one.
There's only one that I know of toward the wrong end of it, not toward the beginning end of it.
Thank you both for all you do to make it such a welcoming place and such a great success.
Well, we're open Saturday.
Wow. Supposed to be another nice day. Last week was great. My wife and I had a nice day down there, Mark. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Well, why don't we take a vote?
Yeah.
Would you like to do the...
Sure. I'd like to make a motion to proclaim Saturday, August 8th, 2015 as Farmers Market Day in Hingham.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right.
Thank you for coming in.
Thank you so
much.
Happy 4th.
Thank you.
Happy 4th. Okay, next on the agenda, we are going to address the Recreation Commission vacancy. With those that are interested, please join us at the table. I understand we have an opening.
We do.
The candidate.
Yes.
Right.
Thank goodness.
Right.
Paul Padgett, who had been a wonderful commissioner, unfortunately due to his business, had just had to resign this year. And it was with hard feelings that he had to say, it's just time for me to go. can we find somebody? Because I'll stay on if we can't find a great candidate. But boy, do we have a great candidate. So I said, Paul, it's okay. So anyway, I'll let Bruce speak for himself. But Bruce Thompson had expressed some interest in the rec department and has been around in Hingham for years and can tell you a lot about his experience in Hingham and some of the rec department as well. And I'll let Bruce speak for himself.
Thanks, Vicki.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Bruce Thompson. I'm 70 Black Rock Drive. I'm a 1975 grad of Hingham High. My kids have gone through Hingham schools. They've participated in the youth programs throughout, particularly the sports programs throughout the town. I'll pass along. I'm not sure it came through or not, but I'll just, that's a bio that I have.
We do.
If you open my
business. We're able to review it before the meeting. Thank you.
Okay, good.
Nice copies, so you can see these are shiny and.
I've been involved with the town from the perspective, particularly in a couple of committees at very deep level. I was involved with the Hingham Sports Partnership for a number of years. I was involved in the I was the chair of the scholarship committee, where we looked at qualified seniors for the Will McDonough and the Midge Durgan Award, and I was involved with that and the coordination of that. For many years through the Hingham Sports Partnership. I've been involved with Hingham Youth Hockey. I was the coaching coordinator for a number of years, coached for a number of years, and I've been involved with sports from the perspective of coaching, whether it be baseball or youth hockey. Helped out with some basketball and did some things throughout the, you know, for the town, for the sports committees. Outside of the sports arena, I'm one of the principals of Sampson Insurance Agency. We're a property and casualty family-owned brokerage in Weymouth. I'm the vice president. We've been a family-owned agency for many, many years. We sold the agency on January 1st. I continue, along with other family members, to be the principals, and we're going to be involved with the agency for many, many years. So I'm very involved from that perspective. My role from a business perspective has been marketing and sales, and sales management within the agency, and that's been one of my strengths, I think. The again, outside of the sports arena directly, been very involved over the years with Children's Hospital in their fundraising, and a subset of the larger children's group, because of some of the care my middle son had there. We've been very involved with the funding of golf tournaments and some scholarship funds within the urology group at Children's Hospital. So I've been involved with that. So I'm just I'm looking forward to the opportunity. I know Paul Padgett. I've known him for a long time, back from coaching hockey together. That's our connection. And I spoke with him at length. I've been to several meetings lately with Vicki and Mark and the whole commission, and feel comfortable with the group. Talking with Paul, just trying to get an idea. You know, how can I get involved? How can I get entrenched to understand the Rec Commission? You know, just the understanding through the last couple of meetings, and understanding just kind of a walk around with Vicki and Mark, how broad the Rec Commission is and the kinds of things the department brings to the town. It's just it's exciting to see, and frankly, my eyes are getting opened as to what, you know, if this works and everything goes through and I get approved, how can I, you know, what kind of role can I fulfill? What can I do? You know, and there seems to be an awful lot of opportunities, but it's an impressive group. And, you know, I hope I can bring value to the group and make the, you know, the commission stronger.
Mr. Guiana.
Thank you. Bruce, thank you for stepping up, by the way. I want to tell you that I know we don't really know each other, but yep. We have some similar interests with sports and hockey and sports and hockey and only half kidding.
Sports and hockey.
But in any event, you come very highly regarded. There are a number of folks that I respect their opinions have contacted me to speak highly of you. It makes it easier, at least for me, when we don't have a number of qualified candidates, but I would be remiss if I didn't point out that that I am impressed with your credentials, and I do think you'd be a perfect fit for the board. And I don't really need to say much more than that, but just one quick question. You mentioned, and I was making notes about Will McDonough, Well, you said you were involved in something. I didn't catch what that was.
There was a scholar within Hingham Sports Partnership, a good deal of the fundraising. There's been two, there was and there continue to be two core fundraising events throughout the year. It's a golf tournament and a comedy night. And a lot of the proceeds that the HSP generates, the majority of them go back to the town, as you probably know. You know, the improvement of fields, the addition of funding for youth sports as well as at the high school level, where the budget shortfall has come up. So that's been the core funding mechanism, and that's really the essence of why HSP was founded to begin with. Within that, there was a scholarship group, and each year we'd give a scholarship to a senior that was a graduating a male, female, and we also had the Midge Durgan Award, and we would award that based upon academic as well as athletic and leadership excellence. And I was involved taking those applications, looking through them, vetting them out amongst the HSP board, and putting that all to a vote. So we had multiple nominees from each sport throughout. So it was a fairly large undertaking. I took that on for 3 years. I picked that up from, we had a group of four people that were doing it before, and I kind of jumped into it with both feet, and I did that myself, and it worked out very, very well, and it continues to be a scholarship that HSP awards each year to three qualified people.
So the reason why I asked you is I knew Will McDonough not well. My father-in-law grew up with him in South Boston, so anytime someone of that caliber is mentioned, I want to make sure. I was aware of the scholarship, but I thank you for your efforts, because that man was did more so much for people, and it was quietly done, and it is just a fitting tribute to recognize him, and it's going for a good cause to help kids in school.
I agree. Thank you, Paul.
Bruce, you're filling a position, you're being appointed, but this ongoing is an elected position. Would it be your intention to then seek re-election when the seat expires?
It would, I preface that by saying I want to make sure that I'm adding value to the committee.
Certainly.
But that would certainly, sitting here today, being involved in the meetings that I have, I would hope that I would be able to add value at that point in time. So if there's approximately 2 years of the unexpired term left, if Paul leaves.
Less than a year.
Okay. So I can jump in quickly. To fulfill that, I hope that I can add value to that, and then I would certainly look to run for that.
Sure. Well, and I think your experience and your commitment would suggest that that's not going to be you're going to be adding value right away. As you're looking so far, I'm just interested. You know, a lot of times, you know, you've attended some meetings, which I think is helpful because it shows an interest as well as you know, you're taking the time to invest to understand the responsibilities, the time commitment. Which I think is very helpful. You know, from what you've seen so far, and you know, you talk about the role you'd like to fulfill, are there a couple of initiatives that in particular are really catching your attention, or you know, maybe an opportunity for something that the commission could do that it's not doing right now?
I don't know if I've seen enough of it for that. One thing that we had the meeting brought up was the issue of the trails project throughout the town, and the connection of that, and how the rec works with that. I think that would be of interest to me, to see if I could add value there.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Are you the same Thompson that lived on Chamberlain Run?
No, I get asked that a lot. There are a lot of Thompsons. No, Wickham Ave.
Okay. I was a year ahead of you, but I've seen you around.
Yeah.
I think that your time in Hingham will add value to the board. Perspectives and otherwise, so I'm ready to go. We ready?
Yes.
Anybody from the audience like to chime in, chat, comment?
And Vicki and Sarah, I'm assuming that because both of you are sitting here without any questions and with big smiles on your face, that you are enthusiastic supporters of this.
We are very enthusiastic, and
yes.
as Bruce has said, he has come to many meetings in the last several months, so he has really become part of our team already, and I truly believe the Rec Commission is a commission that really takes advantage of people who come from the business community, so I'm excited for this opportunity.
Okay. Sure.
So if that's all we have to say, I would make a motion to appoint Bruce Thompson to fill the vacancy on the Recreation Commission until the next town election. Roll call by both the Board of Selectmen and Recreation Commission.
So you gotta say by aye, individuals.
Aye.
We're going this way? Aye.
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 You don't get to vote yet.
Yes.
The ayes have it.
Soon.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would just mention, you mentioned Paul Padgett, but we just also want to pass along our thanks and appreciation to Paul for, you know, his many years of service and his great contributions to the commission as well.
We echo that. Thank you very much. Thank you.
It's been fun to work with.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ben.
Next item on the agenda is the goal, it's a continuation of our discussion from last meeting, the goals and objectives for the Board of Selectmen 2015-2016.
Want to go through this?
What did you like?
So I would, you know, for purposes of the audience, you know, every year the Board of Selectmen tries to set its goals, and, you know, I see Carol Britton-Meyer in the audience, and I would just thank you for the article that you put together that was in the Hingham Journal yesterday that really spoke to these different goals and objectives. I think when we saw these the last time as proposed, we asked that everybody kind of take another look and see if there was anything that was missing, anything was different. I think there was one minor adjustment, really, with respect to just proper terminology. But essentially, the four proposed goals remain, you know, financial sustainability, keeping our financial house in order, maximizing the utilization of our assets and making sure our facilities are suitable, the efficient and effective delivery of services, and general welfare and stewardship. And again, I would just make the reference that, so for each of these on the next few slides, we'll see that there are initiatives under each one of them. It's not intended to be an exhaustive list. It's to call out some things that might get a little bit of additional visibility, or things that will require the support and effort of this board, other boards and committees. So if we go on to the first goal of financial sustainability, that has to do with our financial metrics, managing our debt, promoting long-term economic development as a way to mitigate the residential tax burden, and identifying and pursuing opportunities to assist the neediest in our community. Again, these would be four initiatives that would take place this year. I don't know. I know I've reflected. Paul, you had some feedback that I've reflected. I don't know if either of you have any additional feedback on any of these initiatives.
I looked at the document as a whole because I know we gave ourselves a deadline to respond, and I started tweaking it, and then as I started looking at other aspects of it, I said, oh, that's covered rather well. Okay. So in my view, what I find very attractive about what's under consideration here is it's broad enough but specific at the same time and can be used by future boards going forward to maintain a continuity in policy, and I think that's a very positive thing. And I thank you very much for the work you put into doing this.
Anything missing? Anything we've modified?
No, actually, you know, I think I said it last time, Mary. I mean, I think I have an issue with one coming up.
I think we got it.
Well, you know, whatever it is, but the bottom line is that you did an unbelievable job on this.
Thank you.
You have a talent, obviously, and a skill, and you service well, and I mean that at the utmost respect in terms of putting this together. I really liked it. It's good for me. It's very organized, and I don't have any other comments than that for this particular goal.
Okay. So if we go on to the next one, our assets and our facilities, you know, this is going to be a lot of, you know, this is where the Harbor Development Committee is really going to be, you know, doing a lot of work implementing those articles from town meeting. The Town Hall Facility Committee, taking a look at our town facility needs. This is also where, again, town meeting approved the design funds for the North Fire Station renovation, so the building committee has been named. They'll be starting to work. Also down on the harbor, the Barnes Wharf lease, Whitney Wharf. And, you know, again, as we look at asset utilization, an important thing to remember is that the town does own some parcels, the Selectmen's parcel being one of them. And, you know, that's an opportunity to explore affordable housing options on those parcels. Again, you know, some of these initiatives, you know, they could fall under any one of these kind of four categories. Again, I think it's less important which one they fall under and more about having them, you know, having it identified. So, again, I don't know if there are any comments or suggestions.
Just one, maybe a question, Ted, if you might have an answer, or anybody else. On the affordable housing opportunities on town-owned land, I was down at Thaxter Park for a cookout the other day, and I enjoyed myself. I had never been down there before, and I met some really wonderful people from town. And I kind of got a sense of the need, as we've talked over time, about for affordable housing. And one of the issues that was brought to my attention is that, you know, obviously Thaxter Park serves a benefit to the town, but a lot of the times we have elderly couples that both spouses are alive. They sell the house. They can't really afford to buy into something of high price, or they don't want to, obviously. And some of that housing, that at least in that area, is affordable, but it's not necessarily big enough for them. And mm-hmm. So there's a discussion, and so it's not necessarily to change this, but just maybe in terms of the housing, I'm told there's like 15 acres of land, Ted. I don't know if that's true for the housing owns, and there's some interest in developing that, or in how would we play a role in that? That's kind of my question.
Well, the Housing Authority does have a fairly large tract of land. Of course, they own the land, and so all that would have to work through the Housing Authority. We could, you know, the Board of Selectmen could certainly open up a dialogue with the Housing Authority and see if they were interested in talking, but it's clearly an independent agency separate from the town, and we could certainly make that communication if they're so interested. I think the problem the Housing Authority would have is one of the reasons probably why it hasn't been developed is that the state is a little tight with funds coming down to the authorities. And I know that I've, over the years, the Housing Authority has done a good job of trying to manage with limited resources that the state hands out. So, but that's a conversation we can have.
And I'm not looking to do too much too quick. And I was interested in, my interest was piqued by the discussion, and obviously to the extent we can be helpful and work together to, you know, give folks affordable housing in town, especially long-term residents, I would be supportive of that.
Okay. You know, in terms of service delivery, again, you know, obviously the Aquarian is one of those initiatives. You know, one thing that we might want to think about as a board is, you know, in the last 5 years or so, the budgets have been, you know, kind of tell us what you did this year, tell us how much it's going to cost to do it next year. And, you know, one thing I sort of wonder is if perhaps we have an opportunity to say, you know, is there a different way to deliver some of these services? Are there some things we haven't looked at? And I realize that all of our department heads are always looking for those opportunities. But I wonder if perhaps, you know, I think every few years it's kind of a good idea to perhaps put a little more concentrated effort at that. The sewer consolidation agreement, the Plymouth Study Committee, the town administrator responsibilities. I know Paul and I met with the bylaw committee tonight. You're going to be meeting with them sometime in the next few weeks, as well as looking at committee structures for possible efficiency. So, you know, those are some of the initiatives that are identified right now. So I don't know if comments, questions?
Sure. Is it okay? So, yeah, one of my concerns, I was talking to Ted about this, and I think we and I are on the same page, Mary, about one thing. Regarding the exploring opportunities to further the TA responsibilities, Ted had mentioned that you thought a forum might be appropriate at some point, because one of my concerns was we may be putting the cart before the horse.
Mm-hmm.
When we were here at the last meeting, when those folks from the bylaw, you know, and they did a great job in the bylaw article, I really didn't expect them to propose to do anything with regards to further, you know, enhancing the authority of the town administrator. I understand, because I've talked to Karen Johnson, that they're looking long-term and obviously trying to make it attractive, and it has some benefits to the town. I wasn't comfortable with this particular being a goal or priority now, because I really want to hear from folks in town. That forum is something I'm very interested in. And, you know, I guess everybody brings their own perspective. I'm a little reluctant to, I know Tom Carey said to curb the whims of the of elected officials, and I said I didn't take that personally, but you know, there's whims that a lot of people could have, appointed officials and so forth, and this process has worked well. And I think Karen Johnson and I were talking, I don't want to quote her obviously, but I'd be happy to have her speak on it, but the bottom line is that she will, it's good.
Yep.
But the bottom line is that we haven't really seen how what we've done already has worked. And you know, obviously if it works well, and I just keep repeating, nobody in town has ever said to me, boy, we need to change the structure. You know, we need to enhance the authority of a town administrator. I have a committee of people, and my concern was, and I'll say it to
sure,
is that once you get the committee going, you're really spending all their time to actually come up with a proposal to enhance the authority of the town administrator, when I haven't heard any call from, you know, the community to do that. So, you know, and again, Karen and I talked about that, and that, you know, sometimes these things get, and Ted and I think talked about it, sometimes these things can kind of, once they get going, it's anticipated you're going to come up with some change. And I took that to mean an enhanced authority, and, you know, I don't see that. And I'm asking, I'm not saying we have to change, if you guys are agreeable, fine, but I'm just saying is I think we need to have some community input at a forum where people could come in and talk about it. Marshfield is doing that. They're changing their charter, they're proposing, they're talking about it. And I just don't want us to get too far ahead of the game if people in town aren't really.
So here's what I'm going to suggest, only because I think further discussion of this is not on our agenda, but I guess what I would say is a practical matter, if you're okay with this, I think that committee is supposed to be coming back to us with some sort of a proposed charge that we will vote. My view would be, again, with this document, is if for some reason we decide not to pursue something that's on here, it comes off, this is a little bit of a living document. I would say that this being here in this document, in my mind, does not say this is something we're going to go after. It's a possible initiative, but we're going to vote on it. You know, when the committee comes back with a charge, that's part of, I know why I was meeting with them tonight. You know, similarly, you know, with any of these other initiatives, I would see if something were to happen. So I see these as examples. I just want to be careful that we're not having a discussion about the merits of this work without having it posted and without having the committee here.
Right.
So I guess I'll.
I'd like to leave it in. I think that, you know, Mary's addressed it effectively and appropriately. Whatever else I could say would be simply repeating what she said. But I think with it out, then it becomes easy just to forget about it. And I don't want to forget about it. I want to address it.
So Ted, when I'm not saying we are, but obviously, if we did have a forum on that, we'd have to take a formal vote, or would that be just something we would try to set up? How does that work? And I'm not saying we are, but if that was where we were looking at down the line?
If the Board of Selectmen wanted to reactivate the forums that we've had in the past, it's a matter of the Board of Selectmen just picking a date, scheduling it, and you know, making sure that we have the appropriate times with all the committees and space.
Yeah.
Generally, we have it in Sanborn Auditorium, and it's the last
Sunday afternoon.
I think the last few times that we've had it, we've been away from it for a couple of years now. It reasonably well attended the first two. It tapered off, and I think that perhaps is why the board didn't do it, because I think the last time we had maybe, you know, I think 20 or 30 people that were there. I think the committees and the Board of Selectmen outnumbered the citizens. And so that's a lot of effort to go through for, you know, not a lot of feedback. The first few meetings, of course, I think some of you might remember, the halls were packed. We were in the middle of a financial crisis, and a lot of people had a lot of questions about what was going on. And so there was a lot of outpouring of concern. But that's the process. You just set the date and, you know, try to get people there.
Would we do that? Like, obviously, we could do whenever we want, but we set that in a couple of months in advance? Is that how you did it in the past?
Yeah, in the past, what we did is we coordinate with the other committees to make sure that their members and their structures such that they can be there at that time. You know, sort of a collegial discussion. In the past, we've had that with advisory, because it's generally been advisory and selectmen. One year, school committee had a very large role in it. I think we were doing some school building projects, and so we made sure the three boards can be there, the staff could be there, and it's the right day. We, you know, and that's it. Just pick the day, and off you go.
Avoid football games and, you know, yep. Super Bowl.
I mean, I don't know what day it has to be on. I'm not sure if it has to be on a Sunday either. It could be on any day, right? But that would be something we'd have to put on the agenda down the line, and then have some discussion, and then either vote on it up or down. Is that how it would work?
Yes.
Okay, great.
And I would just say that I think if, and so maybe this is a good transition to goal number four, because if you look at the third bullet from the bottom, it says reestablish town forum. One thing that, you know, I would advocate doing, and I think we've talked about it, is doing it sooner in the fall, kind of before, you know, before things are too far along in the town meeting process. I would also suggest that when we set that date, we do it far in advance, and we, you know, really make a concerted outreach effort, because that will help attendance. You know, in addition here, you know, general welfare and stewardship encompasses environmental sustainability, which has to do with the aquifer, the water supply, energy recycling. You know, just one example, the Energy Action Committee is going to participate in the North Fire Station Building Committee meetings. They're not a member of the committee, but a representative is going to be there, so that hopefully, as the project is designed, you know, that their input and their ideas and technology can be part of the conversation. Website and social media for communication. Paul, I think I hope I got the name of the coalition correct. You know, determining what the next steps are. We talked about the town forum, Board of Selectmen Code of Conduct, and something that happens on an annual basis, ethics conflict of interest training for all employees and volunteers.
And Mary, I want to thank you and Paul for caring enough about that issue, about substance abuse prevention, to include it in your goals and objectives.
Absolutely.
You've put work in it. We respect that.
Thank you.
So,
I'd say we're ready for a vote. I'd entertain a motion to adopt the goals and objectives as displayed and discussed tonight as written.
Second?
I'm abstaining.
Abstain on the goals and objectives?
Yeah, I just I don't feel comfortable with that one piece. I know you do, but I don't feel comfortable.
Second. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
I'll just abstain. Thank you, Mary, for the work, though.
Okay. Moving on. I'd like to hold off on the selectmen and town administrator reports until the end of the evening, if possible, and just go through the appointments and the other votes.
Okay,
that's fine.
Okay. All right.
Paul, question for the audience.
Yes. Hi, Jim. Sorry, I didn't see you there. Focused on my votes.
Jim Watson, 291 Rockland Street. Just a suggestion, a confirmation, and a question. Suggestion is on the question of
in that order.
Property taxes. They re-examined Selectman Varian's proposal several years ago with the universal abatement and the revised tax rate. That took a lot of pressure off the lower income owners. So I won't go into it now, but it seemed pretty intriguing and maybe worth pursuing. On the confirmation, as chair of the Housing Authority, we are looking at the Beale Street property. Bob Keyes is doing some research on ways of funding it and developing the proper mix of units. And the question is, what is sewer consolidation?
sewer consolidation agreement is, so you may recall that town meeting a few years ago, the sewer operations have been outsourced to, the DPW is performing sewer, and so there's an agreement, and that agreement has a certain duration to it, so it's up for renewal. And that gives both parties the opportunity to, you know, discuss any matters that need to be adjusted. Yeah. So the consolidation agreement actually, it came up several months ago, and...
I remember now, it's a way of officially using
the
word.
Right, so I think our hope is that the sewer commission, they've had a lot of turnover on the commission in the last year. Our hope is that at their next meeting, that they will adopt an agreement that will then come to us for consideration, and that'll essentially allow the operation to continue.
Like one big DPW, yeah.
That's correct.
I thought you were mixing fluids. I couldn't imagine what it was.
Not that kind of consolidation. Thank you very much.
As I recall, that was highly controversial, but
I can give the board the data on that file.
Thank you.
At a later time.
Yeah, that's another controversy.
Okay.
Okay. Next on the vote list is the proposed vote to adopt ambulance billing rates. And we have some material here. Ted, can you take us through this briefly?
Sure. This reflects a change of increase, and I'll tell you, it's a fairly large increase. It's approximately 80% of the billable rates that we bill out for ambulance runs. Interim Chief Bob Olson completed an analysis, which we ask him to do each year. It details the cost to operate the system. Some of the reasons that our costs are higher than other communities, I will point out, is that, first of all, we run advanced life support ambulances. We also run two ambulances. We run two ambulances 24/7. We do so because there's a need in the community and a desire of the community to have that ambulance respond in an appropriate time. Town's pretty large, length north to east, north to south rather, and you can see that there's problems. We've talked about it with the fourth fire station idea, that sometimes it's difficult to get one ambulance to different places, which is why we moved to the second ambulance decision made about a decade ago for the community. The issue that the ambulance service and all ambulances in the country are facing is a microcosm of the larger issue of Medicare. Our largest customer is Medicare, and they pay us about 50% of our total runs. But Medicare also pays us about 50 cents on the dollar. And they have a determination that says this is all it's Medicare eligible. They do not say this is the only eligible cost. They just simply say this is all we're paying. I think the analogy would be, going to a restaurant, getting a bill, and saying, well, I'm only going to pay half. That's all it's eligible under my scenario. So it's a difficult dynamic, and what it's doing is it's shifting the burden to those that have insurance. And we are entitled to bill private insurance companies that utilize our ambulance service at the full cost of our service. As we do that, some things we did a few years ago to ensure that there's some safety here. And by the way, just to give you some comparison, and we did this here, our rates are consistent with the region and with other communities. Like I said, they're a little higher in certain respects because we are on the north side of Plymouth County. When we look at Plymouth County, for example, and ComStar, which bills across the, as you can see, the average bundles and the are lower than ours because they're considering the whole state, and we're in a rather costly side of the state per se when you compare Western Mass, for example, and. So the rates were set through the billing service in conjunction with the chief to make sure that we could capture the costs of the service. I think 4 years ago we instituted a process whereby if people couldn't afford to pay the copay that the insurance company, or they had no insurance, that there was a process to go through. In the past, the town had simply left it up to the chief, his personal discretion. And we felt, the board at the time felt, that it was important to have some structure around that. So we put some policies that ComStar helped us develop that mirror the hospital policies for allowing people who cannot afford, due to income levels, the cost of the service. We don't experience that very much. Very, very few of those. I would say, less than a half a dozen a year occur of those. Sort of walking you through what this would mean to people, if you're a Medicare patient and you utilize the service, this won't mean much to you because Medicare only allows us to bill a certain amount, and that's prescribed. If you're a private insurer, if you have your own health insurance that you purchase individually or through your employer, then whatever copay or deductibles you have will be required. What we saw happen a few years ago with a couple of people who objected to some of the fees was that a new product that came out a little bit more intensively as the healthcare costs were rising is what I would refer to as sort of a serious accident only policy, $10,000 deductibles, and essentially offered to, when I got out of college, I had a policy similar like that. I think it was called VIP 2000, and I paid $50 a month or something like that. It was a very small amount of money, but I had to eat all my medical expenses up to $10,000. So that's a shifting an individual makes, and it could cause a problem because if you do need an ambulance, well, that could be an expensive bill. But then again, you've made that decision already because you've said, I'm going to pay the first $10,000 of my own medical expenses and realize a lot less every week in my paycheck. We don't offer, just to give you an idea, we don't have those policies here as part of our employment package, but they're out there, and people have to be cognizant of that is a part of their medical expense if they had it. I would say that it's very important, I think, to try to keep the ambulance system running. If for whatever reason running financially secure, I want to make this issue that's not running, and please don't take that as a misstatement. The ambulance shows up whenever it's called. There is no discussion of billing. This is all after the incident. So I want to be very clear that in no cases would any Hingham ambulance not provide a service because of a billing issue. That's mandated by law. They understand that fully, and the billing is somewhat separate from the guys and the women that actually operate on the ambulance. We take that in the administrative office. So I think I've answered everything, but I'm sure you guys have a couple questions. So let me.
How long have the existing rates?
3 years.
And typically, how often do we revisit the rates?
In the past, we've revisited them. It depends on how fast. There have been years where we've revisited them annually. There's been years where we've revisited them every 3 years. We like to try to get into a three-year cycle and have some period of not always being up. But there have been times when Medicare adjusts their billing system and we have to react. Mm-hmm. There's times when Medicare doesn't. And so that will drive a little bit of the rate increase. If Medicare doesn't change things, pull back, change funding analyses, then we likely won't. But when they do, then we have to react.
It seems like many of our current rates are, one third, one half of the the peer communities.
Right. Even though we listed all the rates, we pretty much only provide the third and the fourth, which is the ALS rate, ALS emergency base rate, ALS 1 non-emergency base rate, because we operate it as an ALS service. So even though you see five, six rate structures and the bundling down below, they're all included in the base rate.
Sure.
Some of these are not, and so that's why you'll see some of the differentials.
Thank you.
So, if I may, I want to say I had the opportunity to talk to Ted and Betty the other day about this issue, and I want to thank them for giving me some information. And I did, thank you, I did do some checking because I have some familiarity with Medicare, and I have a little different experience with Medicare than you, Ted. I'm not sure. I was trying to do some more digging, but I didn't really have a lot of time. So one of the things I was thinking on this one, I think I mentioned it, Ted, is I'm not really comfortable voting on it tonight. and I'll tell you why, and I defer to my colleagues as to what they want to do. My concern is, especially with Medicare, it affects the, you know, what I consider the disabled and the elderly disproportionately. So my experience is that clients of mine would get bills saying you are responsible for, you know, some number, and it may not have just been a copay, it's a certain, it's not a $25 payment. And if we're raising our rates and 50% of our calls are Medicare, and I think it's going to impact our seniors, the elderly, and also maybe some of the more vulnerable people in town. And I don't think some of these people have choices. You know, when we talked about certain deductibles and high amounts, and you know, I just, from my own experience, I'm just a little worried about that, and not knowing enough about how this all translates into, you know, the average person, especially the elderly in town. I just didn't feel comfortable. It's good to have the discussion. I'd like to know a little more information about it, and you know, if I get more comfortable with it, I'd be, you know, I could be okay. I know there's obviously some sense of need for it, but if my colleagues want to vote on it, you know, I could always abstain. I just didn't feel comfortable, and I'd be happy to talk a little more about it and try to make sure I get a comfort level where I can vote for it.
What would be the cost in terms of a delay on the vote?
Well, we're essentially looking at trying to bridge what we think is a gap of about $200,000 over the year. So you can look at that on a monthly basis and think that whatever we don't, these rates are effective July, are supposed to be effective after this meeting. So, you know, we'll just wait 2 to 3 weeks on it, and it'll impact your ability to meet your number. You're going to lose 1 month of the 12. So.
Well, what would be the specific information that would be helpful to, you know, kind of, you know, to inform a vote?
Yeah. I think I would like to look a little more into that Medicare issue, because my experience is that there is out-of-pocket expense sometimes when people have Medicare, and maybe some people's good fortune, they have backup insurance.
So how would we, if we push this off, I just want to understand who's gonna look into that. Is that information that we can get? How do we get it?
Is there some way, Ted, of us being able to see, is there anything with the senior center or anything? Do they have any data about these type things, or does the town have any data about, you know, how many people have to pay out of pocket for these things? And I mean, I can get some more information on Medicare, but I'd be happy to get it from anyone else, Ted or anybody else.
I can give you a list of our billings and certainly what are Medicare and what are any residual balances and how people pay those. And I certainly can get all that for you. But like I said, our experience has been, you know, very few people have come forth to, and we send, by the way, we're proactive on this. When we don't get a payment, we send a letter and we say, you know, if you can't afford or can't pay this, there's a process to go through. It's not a public process. It you know, it works through a sense of privacy, because sometimes people are feel a little awkward about not being able to afford things, and that's understandable. You know, we just don't see a lot of utilization there.
What about the billing outfit that we use, or you said the billing department, I believe. Is that somebody that I could talk to, and maybe they might have a better sense, like, say, you've had some familiarity, if I spoke to them about it? I don't think it would.
I'm not sure what you'd gain from them, but I can certainly, it's ComStar, you have it in your package. They serve, they have about over 50% of the market share in the community. They gave a fairly good detailed explanation of it here, and, you know, some of the issues that we're confronting. So,
I did see that they provided some information, and, you know, it's just background, but I mean, I guess I'm just trying to dig a little deeper, and I could probably get Medicare feedback myself, because I mean, I deal with them on a regular basis, and you know, if I find
you
out that
get an opinion from Medicare
as to how they handle, believe
that's
me,
impressive.
I do
deal with them too, man.
I feel your pain on that, yeah. But I'm talking about just a general outlook. I mean, honestly, my experience is that some of my clients have to pay some gaps. So if they're only paying $1,200 on a $2,500 bill, you got some senior or Medicare, how much is he going to have to pay, or she having to pay? I'm just worried about that.
I think what I heard, though, is that there's a vehicle in place that person confronted with that reality to address it through the fire chief.
Okay.
And, I mean, what I also heard was not too many people in this town do that. And what I'm taking away from this conversation is if we don't do this, this is going to be spread out.
I mean, I was just looking, honestly, this isn't something we've talked about over a great period of time, so it was fairly recent for me.
Right.
So I was thinking a 2-week period. If we come back, I don't know what day we'll come back.
That's what I'm trying to figure out, what the cost of that's going to be.
Yeah, well, and don't get me wrong, if you guys are comfortable with it, but I'm not, and so I would not vote, I would abstain. But I really would like to get the information because I think it's important.
Will the, Paul, the information that you would get from Medicare, would that be relevant to, I mean, will that inform the decision for here in Hingham? And I just don't know a lot about the information you'd get. And
well, I think from based on my own experiences is it wouldn't, not every question I can't ask, as Paul says, I can't ask questions about everybody in Hingham, but there's HIPAA regulations and so forth. But just a general policy, my biggest concern is, and Ted may be right, but I might have a different experience. If the bottom line is if they don't have to pay a dime more because Medicare only paid 50 cents in the dollar, that would inform me, you know, and raise my comfort level. But my experience has been that with ambulances and otherwise, they have to pay. Mm-hmm. And I start to worry about that. And if I can dig a little on it and get a little information in the 2 weeks between now and the next meeting, but I don't want to hold you guys up, but I want to raise it because, you know, it may be important for somebody.
So I just want to point out to the board that if the board decides that for some reason that the rate's too high, then what you're telling me is that you're going to create a revenue deficit during fiscal 15. 16 rather, that you know will have to be made up at some point in time somewhere else. So right now we built a budget that's balanced.
I was going to ask you.
That's based upon us collecting revenue to support our ambulance system. I know that the conversation isn't suggesting that, all right, if we're not going to support the ambulance system financially, then we're going to reduce it. But it's going to have to come somewhere. So somewhere within that operating budget, when we go through that process, you know, you remember how we were balancing that budget at the tail end of the year, and we were looking for a few extra this or that. Next year, when we start that process, I'll set the revenue based on your billing. What I'm telling you right now is that I don't want you to set rates anyway. I'm telling you that if you want to meet your budget objectives, these are the rates you need. If you don't want to meet your budget objectives, you want to fund it some other way, we can explore those discussions. That would mean appropriating funds from some other aspect of the budget, reducing another operating expense from another budget, because it is a zero-sum game.
Yeah. And the last thing I'll say on it is to me, raising a fee of some sort, I liken it to a tax, you know, and there's been discussions in throughout the state about raising fees in different, you know, locations, whether it be buildings or services, and people say, geez, that's like a tax, you know, why don't you just call it a tax? I mean, I'm just worried about raising it with not having the answers, you know, and I'm not blaming anybody, but I just have questions. And Ted and I talked, and Betty and I talked about it the other day, and I knew that I wouldn't have all the answers. That's just my honest assessment.
Yes, Carol.
Is there any concern that people might not call for help if they are faced with these fees? Because, I mean, if people are insurance, that could put them under. So is there any concern that people would just not call an ambulance and maybe die, or
So we've been through this a couple times before. The ambulances run as soon as the call comes in. There is no discussion of any financial implication whatsoever. That's all done post-ambulance activity. I believe it's state law, actually, but I'm not exactly, I'm not an attorney, so I don't have that. But they run, period. There's no question whatsoever. And if someone does not, and there are people in town who don't have insurance, and some people pay the bill, other people have contacted the fire department over the years and asked for a reduction in the bill or elimination of the bill because they couldn't afford it. There's a process to go through that. We follow the exact same process that all the hospitals use, a federal act that stipulated how to move through based on income guidelines, so it wasn't arbitrary. In the past, it used to be arbitrary, where if the chief felt that the person was deserving, then the award was made. And that's a difficult position to put an individual in. We gave some structure to it.
and we talked about income levels, and you know, and we followed exactly the you know, the federal model. So I think there is something in place if someone does not is not able to pay for the ambulance. But I want to repeat, the ambulances will run as soon as they're called.
As long as people know that, that's my concern. I'm not going to make it clear on the story.
Please.
If someone doesn't read it, that's my only concern.
Who's in charge of the fire department for that program?
This is under the fire chief.
Chief, okay, well, I could talk to him. Okay.
So, I'm inclined. You know, I understand that we've built a budget on this. I also understand your questions, and I realize that it's a holiday. You know, with the holiday and things, I'd be willing to defer this vote until our next meeting. But what would be helpful for me is any information that you get, could you please, you know, share it with all of us? And I would also say that if for some reason, you know, there's, you know, so please share that, because I think that will inform everybody. I would just also kind of point out in here in this packet that one of the things that is, I think it's on the fourth or fifth page back, but it essentially says, you know, a question I routinely receive from clients is, how high can I set my rates? There's no appropriate definitive answer to this question. The OIG guidance on this matter is to set rates to cover your cost. And so I would just point out that the proposed rates are doing that. Our rates are a little bit higher because we keep two ambulances available at all times, so that there can be so that if one is out on a call, that another can be provided. And I am sensitive to the financial burden that health care costs, these and others, place on everybody, particularly the most vulnerable. I also do point that out. So I'd be okay deferring this vote for 2 weeks, but not any further.
Yeah, I think that's plenty of time, and I think if there's information that's helpful one way or the other, I'd like to have it, because I have the same concerns.
Okay. Any further comment? Questions from the audience? Comments? Okay. Let's move on to the next item of business then, and that is the reappointment of the following members of the 4th of July Parade Committee for a one-year term ending June 30th, 2016. Jason Kane, Melissa Kane, Mary Ellen Carlisle, Monica Cunningham, sorry, Monica, Dina Maria Costa, Jack Dean, DeWitt DeLolliter, Eric Dresser, George Ford, Ginny Gray, Owen Kane, Dan Lahief, Cassie McDermott, Jay McGrail, John Mones, Carrie Murphy, Jim Murphy, Bill Nickerson, Robin Nickerson, Louis O'Day, Glenn Olson, Gabby Rogner, Cindy Tanucci.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
I would just say that on Saturday, the folks that are bringing up the rear on the parade are going to be a lot of these folks. And as we're all enjoying the parade, they are working really hard on Pleasant Street to make sure that it all works. So I would hope that everybody, as they're going by, bringing up the rear in the golf carts, that we take that opportunity to show our appreciation and thanks to all these very hardworking people.
Hear, hear.
Thank you.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Next on the appointment list is a motion to appoint Thomas Hoffman to the 4th of July Parade Committee for a one-year term ending June 30th, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Now, before we vote, I'll just point out that we did not interview Mr. Hoffman, nor do we have his resume, nor do we have a talent bank application, but I think it's generally accepted that he's well-known to the community, and his bona fides are clearly established, so we don't have a problem making this kind of vote.
I think I've met him before.
I think you have.
But I wasn't sure that these type of committees, we did the talent bank. That was not my memory, just so you know.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All right, and here's my favorite. We'll vote to reappoint the following members to the Memorial Bell Tower Committee for a one-year term ending June 30th, 2016. Kenneth Drescher, Joan Ghetto, Martha Ryan, Ian Shalan, Michael Shalan, Dorcas Wagner.
So moved. Second.
Just as a comment, I have to express my appreciation and gratitude for the efforts of these individuals. Historically, they've played, or they've done the bells on Tuesday night down at Old Ship Church, and it's the memorial tower that was rebuilt. It's a beautiful sound. So, discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next, I'll entertain a motion to appoint Dave Ellison to the Lincoln Apartment Board of Managers, LLC, for a three-year term ending June 30th, 2018.
So I think I gave input into this particular recommendation. The Lincoln School Apartments, I think some of us may be aware because of the CPC project last year, one of the challenges facing the Lincoln School Apartments right now is the ability to, through cash flow, build up a capital reserve. And the Lincoln School Apartments is looking at different options, considering different financing things that will allow it to continue to provide the very important services it does. Mr. Ellison served on the advisory committee and was involved when this was first purchased. His professional background is that he has practical, long-term financial management experience that I thought would help inform and guide the Lincoln School Apartment Board in making appropriate finance decision. It really has a lot to do with his professional experience. I also think this is going to be a complicated financial decision, and one that may also generate some discussion, and his experience serving on town committees will serve him well. Other people may also know that he was appointed to fill an open position on the light board this past year as well. So some may remember his name from that. So I would make that motion.
Second, I just would like to brief comment on it.
Comment away.
Thank you. So I know that David, I was given his information, contact information yesterday to try to reach out to him because we didn't have a chance to interview him. But there were, just so you, and we have kind of two schools of thought. One school of thought is you've got this experience, you've been on the board before somewhere. And then, you know, there were people, one guy that I took note of who actually interviewed, who submitted a talent bank application, who I mentioned, you know, I don't know him by any means, but I was very impressed. I said, here's the new blood we're looking for.
Yep.
And, you know, I understand sometimes you want to go with folks you know, but, you know, I just lean to people that if there's a process with a talent bank application and this other guy did it and he's qualified, I think we should have given him the shot. And then Dave could have filled in somewhere else. It doesn't make anybody right or wrong. I just feel more comfortable when someone presents themselves and goes through all the hoops that we give that new blood a shot, you know?
And I think my assessment on this, and we may agree to disagree, is that the complexity of the issues facing this board, I think, lend themselves to someone who has both professional and town experience on this particular matter. Again, we're very blessed to have so many talented people from which I think this is going to be difficult decisions facing this board.
And it was a good recommendation you made. I'm just you know, just pointing out that there's a couple of ways to look at it. But
sure.
My only comment is I too know Dave Ellison from the advisory committee. We're friendly, we're not friends. I perceive the role that we're taking a vote to fill as a critically important one, because the Lincoln apartment issue last year was murky to me. And I think that Mr. Ellison's expertise and skills were on display in his public service previously, and I think that that's very appropriate for the kind of challenge that he's looking at. I did consider the individual that you talked about. I pulled the interview notes that I made, and I did make notes, and I'm sure we can find a good spot for that gentleman somewhere.
Good. Very good.
So all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. The next one is I'll entertain a motion to appoint Michael Mercurio as an associate member of the Zoning Board of Appeals for a one-year term ending June 30th, 2016.
And Mr. Mercurio came through the Talent Bank. He served on the Zoning Board of Appeals in a neighboring community where he was previously a resident. He had expressed an interest, and we were very fortunate that this opening became available when Dave Anderson was appointed by the moderator to the advisory committee. So I will make that motion.
Second. And just a quick comment, and it's actually, I just want to make note, because Mary, you and I, and maybe Paul, because I didn't know this, but you and I were in full agreement on him being a perfect fit for that job. And so we do agree and we
disagree. Absolutely.
Periodically, that is true. I actually do agree with you, and I see that the position as an alternate on the ZBA is a good testing ground to examine the suitability for future advancement to the regular member position. I think that the ZBA is one of the most critical boards in this town, and we're very fortunate to have some real talent sitting on there right now, but that's not going to last forever, so we have to look forward.
Okay.
All right.
Did we vote that?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Next on the...
We're on the back page.
This is a big one. To approve the issuance of a special one-day all-alcoholic beverages liquor license to the Hingham Historical Society, care Suzanne Buchanan, for the Bond Ball fundraiser to be held at 1030 Main Street on Saturday, September 26, 2015, from 7 to 10 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I'll entertain a motion to approve the request of the Hingham Downtown Association to use the sidewalks for the annual summer sidewalk sales on July 23rd, 24th, and 25th, 2015, from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'll entertain a motion to approve the request of the Hingham Downtown Association for the use of Main Street between Elm and South Streets for Summerfest to be held on July 25th, 2015, from 12 p.m. to 3 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Entertain a motion to waive the building permit fees for the Hingham Housing Authority's 132 Scotland Street project.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. So we're holding off on the issue with respect to the ambulance rates. We've done everything else. At this point, we're going to do selectmen and town administrator reports. Mr. Alexiadis, do you have anything you'd like to add?
I've been asked repeatedly almost every day whether the Aquarian decision has come down, so I'd like to report to the board that it has not come down. Enjoy your 4th of July weekend free of worrying about that.
Okay. Mr. Gannon, anything you want to add?
Well, I just want to make sure I wish everybody a happy 4th of July. I hope you get the opportunity to take some time to relax and enjoy your family and your friends. I just point out to anybody, you know, that's interested, they're still taking applications for the road race on Saturday.
Be right on it.
Well, it doesn't have to be you, but I'm saying it is great. I'm running with my daughter. I was able to get one of the two to run, and it's great fun to see a lot of your neighbors and friends. Some people walk it, and there's plenty of people cheering us on, and then I look forward to seeing everybody a beautiful day on Saturday for the parade.
I have one thing. It's a little bit of business, but just to let you know and to let the public know, I represented the town at the Plymouth County Advisory Board meeting last week, and that was a meeting to vote on both the revenue and the expense budget for Plymouth County. Hingham, as part of our state assessment, we pay approximately $148,000 that comes out of our operating budget, and that's for, you know, our share of things like it funds the courts, it funds the Registry of Motor Vehicles, it funds 4-H. I would mention that a young lady, Lily Raposa from Hingham, gave a presentation on 4-H that was just dynamite. There was discussion about the budget. The budget, both the revenue and the expense, passed unanimously. I would say that my impression as the first Plymouth County meeting that I attended is that one of the things that the commissioners are grappling with is that the amount of money from the Registry of Deeds that trickles down to Plymouth County, it's very low. And efforts are being made to try to get the state to, you know, pass some of that along to the county. And my assessment is that that's going to be really important for Plymouth County to continue to provide the services. I think the question is, you know, if you look at the state budget situation, I'm not sure that the Baker administration at this point is ready to sort of give up some dollars. So I think it's something we have to keep. I think it's something we have to keep an eye on. I think the commissioners have put together a budget that results in a lot of headcount reductions. There were a number of layoffs. Everyone is trying their best not to reduce service levels. It's going to be very difficult. I think here in Hingham, we need to keep our eye on it. And I think we will look forward to receiving the report from the Plymouth County Study Committee that will essentially be a report to us to say, if by chance something happens within the county, sort of what do we do then? What's our plan? I think this is something we need to continue to monitor. And so I appreciate the opportunity to represent the town. And I did vote for the revenue budget and for the expense budget as presented.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I met with Mr. Carey, Ms. Johnson, and Mr. Ross earlier this evening with respect to a charge that they're contemplating presenting to us, as well as a discussion on an anticipated code of conduct. It's my intention to ask them to accelerate the effort as it relates to the code of conduct so that we can have one in place with all deliberate speed. You know, the earlier discussion tonight for me was unpleasant for a couple of reasons. Our town employees have rights. If you're a member of a committee, you're considered a special employee. And to discuss the qualifications or the standards of their performance in a public setting requires certain notice requirements be fulfilled, and provides them with the option of having the discussion held in an open session, or what we commonly refer to as the executive session. I applaud Mr. Alexiadis for his restraint in the last two meetings that we've gone through. I intend to contact town council and request a meeting between the three of us in executive session to address this going forward, so that we do not continue to have these kind of discussions, which in my view put the town at a certain legal risk. This is a fine line between the right to free speech, the employees' rights, whether it's Mr. Alexiadis or any other individual that's on a committee. I'm not in the habit, nor do I intend to get into any kind of practice where I publicly disparage anyone in this town that wants to come and serve either as a paid employee or as a volunteer. You know, I spoke to the basis for the appointment that we make. These appointments, ladies and gentlemen, simply, you know, the bottom line is there is a certain amount of subjectivity to it. You know, at the Memorial Day celebration that we had in the Common, a gentleman came up to me afterwards, and I recognized his facial features from having done business with a family member when I was a young boy. And I had read in the gentleman's obituary that he was the recipient of a Silver Star. So we spoke to that, and this gentleman said, well, he actually got two Silver Stars. and I got one myself in Vietnam. And it just made me think once again that this is a very big town. And we have a lot of different people here from a lot of different walks of life, a lot of different experiences. It's my hope, and I know that Mr. Gannon and Ms. Power share the view, that we want to encourage people to step forward and bring their experiences, bring their expertise. We're trying to do that in a productive, positive way. It may not have seemed like that tonight, but that certainly is the intention, at least that I share, and I'm certain that my colleagues do as well. I'd just like to close with a bit of a caution. I attended depositions out in Worcester today, and I saw two very serious high-speed accidents. This is a very dangerous weekend for motor vehicle accidents, and I just urge the public to use great caution, especially motoring through the town here. And Saturday, I anticipate that on public radio, the reading of the Declaration of Independence occurs. And it's a great experience to sit there and listen to it being read and reflect on what it means to all of us as citizens of the United States of America on this very special day. So with that, I'll say good night.
Can I just, one last?
Can I ask a question?
I'd rather end it this way.
I just want to make one comment. I support your suggestion that we give town council come speak to us, and I had spoken to him, and
we will do that.
We're able to
with
talk
all
about
deliberate
the process.
Speed.
Yes, good.
Yes, Carol.
I just have a couple questions.
Sure.
Okay.
Just a couple of things, just to get it straight, because I think people are reading the paper and they're wondering, but I know that you can talk to Ted, and that's part of it, but it just seemed like there was an awful lot of behind-the-scenes discussions about the appointments that led to confusion, and I'm just wondering how it works, like what the fine line is between you can't all talk together, but if you're transferring information from one to another, I'm just wondering how that goes.
Well, we can talk together out here publicly. We can't signal to Ted how we're going to vote, and I anticipate that the code of conduct that we're going to be asked to consider will address that definitively. We can certainly share with him our views on, in this case, a potential appointment. But I cannot pick up the phone and call Mary Power. I cannot pick up the phone and call Paul Gannon and say, hey, Paul, this
but
is
where is the fine line?
The line is, so I think the line is, and it's, I think it's called a serial violation, but essentially, you know, yes. So for example, and I'm going to take it out of appointments because it seems to be kind of emotionally charged. So let's say the ambulance fees, right? What we can't do is, you know, I can't say to Ted, I'm ready to vote the ambulance fees, and then, you know, Paul Gannon says, I'm ready to vote the ambulance fees, and then Ted were to say to Paul Healy, so these two are ready to vote. So our town administrator, and he does a good job, he helps keep us along the path to make sure that we are communicating information without it crossing the line of being backroom dealing.
It just sounded like it happened during this last thing.
Well, and what happened with the appointment process is that each of the three of us was asked to put forward a list of candidates.
I was not.
Which, okay, well.
Not on the appointment. I mean, we were.
So, and then we all received a document that contained a list of possible appointments. So that was prepared by the town administrator based on the input that was provided. But so that's, okay. You know, that's where we try to draw the line.
I need to hear it. Okay, and I have another question. I'm just curious, and you mentioned this last week a little bit, and I didn't have a chance to ask, but this Aquarian, I'm confused, because I thought initially when we voted, I think it was 350, was that the first Aquarian litigation legal fee vote at town meeting, was it 350? I think it was going to be 500, then it was reduced, but I'm just wondering, because I thought, and other people have said to me, that they thought that town meeting was supposed to, after that, approve any more allocations, and it's been, now it's up to 1.1 million. So I'm just wondering what happened.
So what happens with our, I can handle this as advisory, and Ted, help me if,
sure.
So, you know, Carol, thank you for the question. So
you know, so what'll happen is that when, you know, when town meeting approves, they approve a budget or they approve a warrant article for expenditure. So with respect to, you know, budgets or warrant articles, we also have a reserve fund, and the reserve fund is maintained by the advisory committee. It represents about, it's 3/4%.
Yes.
And the idea is that it's used for extraordinary or unintended, you know, expenses. So, you know, an ambulance loses an axle and we have to replace, you know, we have to replace that. It's not in the budget.
Without having to call a town meeting.
Without having to call a town meeting. Thank you. And so in the case of Aquarian, which are part of our legal expenses, when the town meeting a year ago approved funds to continue the litigation. During that, subsequent to that town meeting passage, the town incurred additional expenses associated with that litigation. And the path to that, similar to others, is to request a reserve fund transfer, which ultimately is the advisory committee's decision. Our protocol in Hingham is that the Board of Selectmen typically reviews those and makes its vote to inform the advisory committee. And in the case of the Aquarian litigation, you know, what you can probably appreciate is that it is extremely difficult to estimate with accuracy litigation, because when you think about it, there's only so much of the litigation that one party can influence. And so, as we went through the litigation, we found that there were additional matters that came up that, for the town to conclude the trial, required a reserve fund transfer. There was one requested earlier in the year that was, Ted, was that February?
Yes.
In February, and then in the closeout of the year. The litigation has concluded, and all of the costs associated with that litigation were reflected in that final transfer amount. So again, we have a reserve fund that is intended, because otherwise, you know, as Ted said, we'd have to, you know, call a town meeting.
People's concern is that, I'm not saying it's mine, that people have just been concerned, because even though I understand what you're saying, that they still felt that they were going to be apprised of it and be able to vote on further things. That was the way it was presented at town meeting, the way I recollect it. So I'm just passing on people.
Sure.
Because I can't answer for you.
And sure. Mary, you were right. Carol, I'm sorry. Carol, I'm sorry.
Long night.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, a little bit.
So what I had said the last time was, or at least if it's the same conversation, is that I was getting uncomfortable keep voting transfers without people from the community giving their opinion. I thought at this point of the game, there was a bill due, we had to pay it, but I was kind of just putting my two cents in that in the future, I want the community to be able to weigh in on this, hopefully by a vote, but that's, you know, we'll discuss that, because I think it's their decision ultimately where to go from here.
I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll move.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Good night.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.